May we join those first Palm Sunday worshipers as they welcome Jesus into Jerusalem, even though he came in lowliness and humility. It was a celebration because he came to win our salvation. And that is what we are doing today as well. We will be processing in with the palms this morning, and we will be focusing on our Savior's passion. Maybe if you had a chance to read the service notes, it mentions during the Reformation that Palm Sunday developed another descriptive name, Passion Sunday. And that is what our service today will focus on, is the passion of our Savior as we review the passion history as recorded in the Gospel of Luke. As it prepares us for Holy Week now, and as we watch our Savior go to the cross and ultimately win our salvation for us. And a week from today, as we celebrate the fact that his tomb is empty, he has conquered his death for us. So we'll begin then with the responsive reading and commendation of the Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna to the Son of David.
Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for your great acts of love, by which you redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ. As he was acclaimed by those who scattered their garments and branches of palm in his path, so may we always hail him as our God and King, and follow him with perfect confidence, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Hear now the Palm Sunday Gospel. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethphage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' tell him the Lord needs it." Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They replied, "The Lord needs it." They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Let us go forth in peace.
In the name of the Lord.
Thank you. Please be seated. At this time, I invite the children to come forward for the children's devotion. Good morning. That was a little different, huh? We don't do that every Sunday, do we? We don't have palm branches in our hands and walk into church while we sing. But today is a special day. Does anyone know what today is? Did anyone remember what they heard? Today is, Evie? Palm Sunday, hence the palm branches, right? And we were processing in, we were kind of like a parade, if you will. We were coming into church and we were singing praises, much like they did on the first Palm Sunday. Because who was coming to Jerusalem on that first Palm Sunday? Who was riding into Jerusalem, Aaron? It was Jesus, right? And they were singing Jesus' praises. Even though he came into Jerusalem humbly, they were singing his praises. And it's kind of like they threw him this big parade. How many of you like to go to parades? Do you like to go to parades? Evie, you do? You the only one? No one else like? Yeah, Daniel, you like to go to parades? What's your favorite part of a parade? Why are they so much fun? What do you think, Maggie? You can watch them on TV too. Yeah, there's some big parades that are on TV, right? There's usually marching bands. It's really upbeat and festive, right? Sometimes they throw candy. I think I remember that as being one of my favorite parts as a kid, right? They throw candy at the parades. What kind of events do we go to parades for? Or what kinds of events are being celebrated when we have a parade? Aaron, can you think of one? A holiday? Yeah, sometimes there's a Christmas parade if it isn't too cold out, right? That's kind of fun to go to. The 4th of July, right? That's probably one of the main ones that you've all been to, right? The 4th of July parade. You know another one? A Thanksgiving parade. Yeah, it's another one that can be kind of cold too, but those are fun, right? So it's usually an upbeat thing that we're celebrating. But if you think about what Jesus was going into Jerusalem to do, it's kind of strange that they were celebrating, that they were having a parade. What was Jesus going to Jerusalem to do? Your hint is behind me. What was he going to Jerusalem to do? Look up. Aaron. He went to die on the cross for our sins. And that's kind of strange to celebrate someone's death, right? Do we have parades when people die? Not usually, right? It's not usually a time that we celebrate. And yet, why do we celebrate Jesus' death? We even call the day that he died, we call it good, right? It's Good Friday. Why do we call that good? Why is Jesus' death so good for us? Anyone know? Aaron? Very good. He took away our sins, right? He took away our sins, and because of that, we get to go to heaven to be with him forever. And that is what our service is going to focus on today, is the passion of Jesus, how Jesus was on trial, how he suffered, and ultimately how he was nailed to a cross and died to take away our sins. So make sure you listen during the service today as we hear that passion history once again, and we remember how Jesus suffered in our place so that, as Aaron said, our sins could be forgiven and we can go to be with him forever in heaven. And that is a reason to celebrate, isn't it? Not just today on Palm Sunday, but each and every day. Thank you for coming down. You can go back to your pews, and we'll continue then with our first reading. Our first reading is Luke chapter 22, verses 1 through 38. The feast of unleavened bread, which is called the Passover, was approaching. The chief priests and the experts in the law were looking for a way to put him to death, because they were afraid of the people. Satan entered Judas, called Iscariot, who was one of the 12. He went and spoke with the chief priests and officers of the temple guard about how he could betray Jesus to them. They were glad and agreed to give him money. He made a promise and was looking for an opportunity to betray Jesus to them when the crowd was not present. Then came the day of unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb was to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go prepare the Passover for us, so that we may eat it." They said to him, "Where do you want us to prepare it?" He told them, "Right when you have entered the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him into the house that he enters. Tell the owner of the house, 'The teacher says to you, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large furnished upper room. Make preparations there." They went and found things just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. When the hour had come, Jesus reclined at the table with the 12 apostles. He said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." He took a cup, gave thanks, and said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you, from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." He took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after the supper, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is being poured out for you. But look, the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. The Son of Man goes as it has been determined, but woe to that man by whom he is betrayed." They began to discuss with one another which of them it was who was going to do this. Then a dispute arose among the disciples about which of them was considered to be greatest. But he told them, "The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who have authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Instead, let the greatest among you become like the youngest, and the one who leads like the one who serves. For who is greater, one who reclines at the table or one who serves? Isn't it the one who reclines at the table? But I am among you as one who serves. You are those who have remained with me in my trials. And I grant you a kingdom, even as my Father granted to me, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom. And you will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel." The Lord said, "Simon, Simon, pay attention. Satan has asked to have you all, so that he may sift you as wheat. But I prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. And when you have returned to me, strengthen your brothers." He said to him, "Lord, I am ready to go with you both to prison and to death." But Jesus replied, "I tell you, Peter, the rooster will not crow today until you deny three times that you know me." He said to them, "When I sent you out without money bag, traveler's bag, and sandals, did you lack anything?" "Nothing," they said. Then he said to them, "But now whoever has a money bag, let him take it, and likewise a traveler's bag. And let the one who has no sword sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you that the scripture must be fulfilled in me: he was counted with transgressors. For what is written about me has its fulfillment." They said, "Lord, look, here are two swords." He said to them, "That is enough." This is the word of the Lord. We continue with hymn 110, verses 1 through 3.
Thank you. second reading is Luke chapter 22, verses 39 to 54. Jesus left and went out to the Mount of Olives, as was his custom. His disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he told them, "Keep praying that you may not enter into temptation." He withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down, and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. As he was in agony, he prayed more fervently. His sweat became like great drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose from prayer, he went to his disciples and found them sleeping from sorrow. He said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray, so that you may not enter into temptation." While he was still speaking, suddenly a crowd appeared, and a man called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He came near to Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said to him, "Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss?" When those who were around him saw what was about to happen, they said to him, "Lord, should we strike with a sword?" Then one of them struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus responded, "Stop, no more of this." Then he touched the servant's ear and healed him. Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple guard, and the elders who had come out against him, "Why have you come out against a robber with swords and clubs? Each day when I was with you in the temple courts, you did not lay hands on me. But this is your hour, when darkness rules." Then they seized him, led him away, and brought him into the high priest's house. This is the word of the Lord. We continue with hymn 104, verses 1 through 3.
Our third reading is Luke chapter 22, verses 54 through 71. Peter followed at a distance. When they had lit a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat down among them. A servant girl saw him sitting near the light. She looked intently at him and said, "This man also was with him." But he denied it, saying, "Woman, I do not know him." After a little while, someone else saw him and said, "You also are one of them." But Peter answered, "Man, I am not." About an hour later, someone else was firmly insisting, "Truly this man is with him too, because he is a Galilean." But Peter said, "Man, I don't know what you are talking about." At that very moment, while he was still speaking, the rooster crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the Lord's word, how he had said to him, "Before the rooster crows today, you will deny me 3 times. He went outside and wept bitterly. The men who were holding Jesus in custody mocked him while they beat him. They blindfolded him and kept asking him, "Prophesy, who hit you?" and they went on saying many other blasphemous things against him. As soon as it was day, the council of the elders of the people met together, both chief priests and experts in the law. They brought him into their Sanhedrin and said, "If you are the Christ, tell us." But he said to them, "If I tell you, you will not believe, and if I ask you, you will not answer me or release me. For from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God." They all said, "Are you then the Son of God?" He said to them, "You are saying so, and I am." Then they said, "Why do we need any more testimony? For we ourselves have heard it from his own mouth." This is the word of the Lord. We continue with hymn 114, verses 1 through 3.
Our fourth reading is Luke chapter 23, verses 1 through 25. Then the whole group of them got up and brought him before Pilate. They began to accuse him, saying, "We found this fellow misleading our nation, forbidding the payment of taxes to Caesar, and saying that he himself is Christ, a king." Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered him, "It is as you say." Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowd, "I find no basis for a charge against this man." But they kept insisting, "He stirs up the people, teaching all through Judea, beginning from Galilee all the way here." When Pilate heard this, he asked if the man was a Galilean. When he learned that he was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem during those days. When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad. For a long time he had wanted to see him, because he had heard many things about him. He hoped to see some miracles performed by him. He questioned him with many words, but Jesus gave no answer. The chief priests and experts in the law stood there, vehemently accusing him. Herod, along with his soldiers, treated him with contempt and ridiculed him. Dressing him in bright clothing, he sent him back to Pilate. Herod and Pilate became friends with each other on that day. Before this, they had been enemies with each other. Pilate called together the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, and said to them, "You brought this man to me as one who is misleading the people. Look, I have examined him before you. I have found in this man no basis for the charges you bring against him." Herod did not either, because he sent him back to us. "See, he has done nothing worthy of death, so I will punish him and then release him." Now he needed to release one prisoner to them at the feast. But they all shouted together with one voice, "Take him away, release Barabbas to us." Barabbas had been thrown in prison for a rebellion in the city and for murder. Then Pilate addressed them again because he wanted to release Jesus, but they kept shouting, "Crucify, crucify him." He said to them a third time, "Why? What evil has he done? I have found no grounds for sentencing him to death, so I will whip him and release him." But they kept pressuring him with loud shouts, demanding that he be crucified, and their voices were overwhelming. So Pilate decided that what they demanded would be done. He released the one they had asked for, who had been thrown in prison for rebellion and murder, but he handed Jesus over to them to do as they wished. This is the word of the Lord. We continue with hymn 105.
Our fifth reading is Luke chapter 23, verses 26 through 43. When they led him away, they see Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country. They placed the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A large crowd of the people was following him, including women who were mourning and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, stop weeping for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. Be sure of this, the days are coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the childless women, the wombs that never gave birth, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do these things to the green wood, what will happen to the dry?" Two other men who were criminals were led away with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." They were casting lots to divide his garments among them. The people stood watching, and even the rulers were ridiculing him, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself, if this is the Christ of God, the Chosen One." The soldiers also made fun of him, coming up to him and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription written above him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals hanging there was blaspheming him, saying, "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him, "Don't you fear God, since you are under the same condemnation? We are punished justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come in your kingdom." Jesus said to him, "Amen, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." This is the word of the Lord. We continue with hymn 125.
Thank you.
Our final reading is from Luke chapter 23, verses 44 through 56. It was now about the sixth hour, and darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. The sun was darkened. The curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had happened, he began to glorify God, saying, "This man really was righteous." All the crowds gathered to see the spectacle. When they saw what had happened, they returned home beating their chests. All those who knew him and the women who followed with him from Galilee stood at a distance watching these things. Now there was a man named Joseph from the Jewish town of Arimathea, who was a member of the council, a good and righteous man. He had not agreed with their plan and action. He was looking forward to the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. He took it down, wrapped it in linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb that was cut out of rock, where no one had yet been laid. It was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was beginning. The women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed after Joseph and observed the tomb and how his body was laid. They returned and prepared spices and perfumes. On the Sabbath, they rested according to the commandment. This is the word of the Lord. We continue with hymn 718 in the blue supplement.
Thank you.
Please stand for prayer. Lord Jesus, you are the King of heaven and earth. We join the first Palm Sunday worshipers in praising and glorifying you for coming to this earth to be our Savior. Though you are one with God the Father and Lord of all, you humbled yourself and became one with us. Thanks be to you for living a life of perfect conformity to God's holy law in our place. Praise be to you for being obedient to death, even death on a cross, to redeem us from sin. Cause our voices to blend with those who sang your praises as you rode into Jerusalem. Move us to confess you before others as our Lord. Help us proclaim the message of peace and forgiveness to people of all nations. Use us to assure all people that your blood has cleansed them from sin and set them free from slavery to sin, death, and the devil. Move us to dedicate all we are and have to your glory. Lord Jesus, you are King over all the earth. Bless the nations of this world with wise rulers and good government. Let peace prevail. Grant success to the businesses and industries of our land to serve for the common good. Cause all employers to be honest and fair-minded, and all employees to be diligent and faithful. Look with favor on our nation's schools. Be with those who teach and those who learn. Comfort the sick and the afflicted with the assurance of your care and protection. Strengthen the faith of the dying. And hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Dear Savior, as we walk with you this week toward Calvary, keep us focused on your purpose for coming into this world and on our calling to spread this wonderful message of salvation. Hear us for your mercy's sake. Amen. And we join in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Please remain standing for our closing hymn.
Lord, save your people.
Please be seated. Good morning once again. We're glad that all of you could join us for worship this morning. I'd like to thank those readers who helped with our service this morning. We appreciate the time you put in. Just a reminder that you will have a number of other opportunities to worship this Holy Week. Our next service will be on Monday, Thursday at 6:30 p.m. That is a communion service. And then the next day on Good Friday, our Good Friday Tenebrae service or service of darkness will take place at 6:30 p.m. on Good Friday. And then on Easter Sunday, our day begins at 7:30 with what we call an overture service, which is basically a brief communion service that starts at 7:30. And then at 8 until 9:30, the Easter breakfast will be served. You can show up at any time during that time for your Easter breakfast. And then at 9:30, we will have our Easter festival service. So please make plans to join us for all those worship opportunities. Also, please note that 2 weeks from today, Sunday, April 24th, will be our next quarterly voters meeting. That will start at noon right after Bible class. And one of the items on the agenda will be the parking lot repair, this back parking lot. And right now, we're getting some quotes around $42,000 to repair that. And so we will be discussing ways to cover the cost of that repair. So that will just be one of the items on the agenda for that quarterly voters meeting 2 weeks from today. At this time, I invite you to join us for Bible class and worship this morning following our coffee hour. Lord's blessings on your Holy Week worship.